My name is Lucy Montgomery and I'm the Director of the Centre for Culture and Technology, and we're incredibly proud that Frances is not only a recipient of an honorary doctorate at Curtin, but she's also an adjunct professor associated with the Centre for Culture and Technology, and we've been working closely with the library on putting this event together. So thank you to Catherine too. So I'm going to start by introducing our two panellists. So the format for today is, I need to begin by acknowledging the past and present traditional owners of the land that we're having this event on, and in particular the really important contribution that they're continuing to make to the life of Curtin and to the work that we're doing here. And now on to our format. We're going to have a keynote presentation by Frances today, and we're going to follow that with a panel style discussion, and we hope that we might get some questions for the audience or from the audience, and following that we'll be moving into the gallery foyer for tea and scones if people would like to stick around and have a chat. So our two panelists today are Jane Fraser, who's the CEO of Fremantle Press. And Jane has worked in trade and education publishing for over 20 years, following 5 years in San Francisco with an international coeditions publishing company. She moved back to her hometown of Sydney, and then she came to join us in Perth, where she worked in corporate marketing and communications. And she joined Fremantle Press in 2008, as a non-fiction publisher, and she's been CEO since 2010. So we're really happy to have Jane as a trade publisher who we hope is going to provide some different perspectives on the sort of scholarly communication topics that we are sort of familiar with. The other panellist today is Catherine Clark. She's very bravely agreed. to join our panel discussion. And Catherine is the University Librarian and Director of the John Curtin Prime Ministerial Library at Curtin University. Catherine has held various positions with the Australian Library and Information Association, including as the convener of the Western Australia Group. She's an executive committee member of the Australian Open Access Support Group, and a faculty member of the Australian Evidence-Based Practice for Librarians Institute. And finally, our keynote speaker today is Frances Pinter. And Frances is an eminent academic publisher and recipient of a Curtin University Honorary Doctorate of Letters in recognition for her services to scholarly publishing. She's also founder of Knowledge Unmatched, which is a not-for-profit company working to create a sustainable route to open access for scholarly publications. I'm really delighted that Frances has been able to come back for this week and for this event, and I'm looking forward to hearing her talk. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Lucy. I'm delighted to be here and delighted to be able to speak to you. I've got an awful lot of slides, and I'm not going to go through all of them, but they will be on a slide share. So the idea was to be comprehensive, leave something comprehensive behind, because I'm going to try and keep to schedule, although we are starting 3 minutes late only. Okay, so the subtitle, Applying an International Lens, was very challenging, but I narrowed this talk down from it not being about books generally, but we're looking at monographs, and that's what most of you are concerned with. So it's a very specific type of book. And what is a monograph? Well, There are lots of definitions, but this is the one I'm using. A long academic and peer-reviewed work on a single topic, normally written by a single author, or it can include peer-reviewed and edited collections by multiple authors. And the reason monographs continue to be important, especially in humanities and social sciences, is because the writing of a long-form publication, monograph, is the research process. And that's really quite different from the way that science is communicated. So monographs are important. They play a unique role in knowledge creation and scholarly communications. They're different from articles. They're not long articles. And so we have to pay attention to them. So when I was thinking about how do we get to open access for monographs and how to present that succinctly, I came up with this particular picture. And it's an octagon and it has 8 segments. And there's no rational reason for the sequence. And indeed, Catherine pointed out to me when I went through it with her, she said, well, why don't you start with who we're really concerned with, which are the authors and the readers? And I thought she was right, so I've changed the sequence of my presentation, but I don't have the software on my laptop to change the way the diagram looks. But there are serious systemic challenges about moving from the closed model, selling units one by one by one, to open access. Why are the policies so vague? Where is the funding going to come from? Why are publishing costs so hard to pin down? And how does open access fit in with the new digital landscape, with the changes in the way knowledge is generated and the way scholarly communications work? So I took my model and I did this with it. It kind of represents where we are now. It's all something of a mess. The different segments don't work well together. But the good news is it's all moving in the right direction. And that's what I'm going to be talking about as I move from segment to segment, to give you, I hope, the feeling that things are moving forward very well. Slowly, but I would say within 5 years' time, we will have a predominantly OA world and ecosystem for monographs. So I'm going to start with the authors and readers segment. And with each of these segments, the first slide will just be a little summary of what we're going to be talking about, like a roadmap. So what do authors think about OA? I'd like to think they love OA, but I've got a question mark, because actually, they don't all love OA. I think they're ill-informed. I think they just don't know yet what the benefits are. But actually, in a survey that I was involved with, attitudes vary between countries, between disciplines, and even among researchers within disciplines, depending on where they are on the career ladder. Furthermore, the most vocal voices amongst academics against OA have been those who see the challenges of things like third-party rights permissions as insurmountable obstacles. You know the kind of person, it's the kind of person where the glass is half empty as opposed to half full. Actually, those issues only pertain to a minority of monographs. So I don't think there should be anything stopping us. But some studies have shown that there is just not enough understanding of how open access works for monographs and not an appetite for it. But the benefits for authors are very clear. Usage figures, they get usage figures of downloads, of viewings. They can see how far their monographs have traveled. They can get increased exposure and impact. My favorite anecdote on this is I was the CEO of Manchester University Press. I looked at 100 books that we'd had on OA for 5 years, and I looked at the downloads. These are books, monographs, that normally would sell 200 copies. And I saw that the average number of downloads was 7,000. Now that's remarkable. So I trotted off to the vice chancellor and I said, look at this, this is really remarkable. And furthermore, they've been downloaded in 208 countries. That's better brand recognition than Manchester United. So the vice chancellor looked at me and said, we only have students from 180 countries. I want the list of your 200 countries that have been downloaded because we have to get more students. So, you know, this was really good PR for the press and of course wonderful for the authors. So here's a slide. If you're interested, go and see some of these authors, what they have to say. These are thoughtful pieces about the benefits for them. So authors, readers, I think we've done that. But I also want to talk about licensing. There's flexibility about how the licenses work, and you're all familiar with the Creative Commons licenses. But what's interesting, a difference between books, monographs, and articles, is that generally publishers don't take the copyright for monographs. Generally, they enter into a contractual relationship with publishers, and therefore it's the author that defines the license, whether they use no derivatives license or not. And that's very important because it gives the author control over things like translations. So they can make sure that the translations that are done are well done. I won't go into how this has been constructed, but it's there. It shows great variation in 8 countries as to the kinds of licenses that have been popular, not popular. And you can see more about that in a report that I'm going to talk about. So, what do we want to keep and what do we want to improve for both authors and readers? Quality assurance, peer review. The editorial services for monographs are valued by their authors. We've seen that in survey after survey. New software is coming on stream to make it easier to publish monographs, and easier to use platforms are coming along as well. We're not there yet, but it's all going in the right direction. So policies, OA policies. You live in a country where you already have mandated open access, not just for articles, but also for books. That's not the case in all countries. It's not the case for all countries that have mandated articles, but they have also mandated books. They have not always done so. So what am I going to talk about? I'm going to talk about what's happening in Europe. I'm also going to talk about what's happening in the UK. This is where I burst into tears over what is happening to my poor country. But I won't go into the politics of Brexit. There are actually some interesting things happening with regard to OA, which I'll talk about in a moment. And the UK comes from a very different tradition of publishing than continental Europe. Most of the comments that I'm going to make come from this report, which I and 2 other colleagues did for an organization called Knowledge Exchange. We compared 8 European countries in depth, and it's a terribly long piece of work. Lucy has a copy, but I would have gone overweight with my bags if I brought more than one, but it is online. So please do have a look if you're interested. One of the things that we realized is having a policy is not the same as mandating, and that there was a process in between which was all about encouraging. So even if you have a policy, you got to encourage the right players to mandate and to have the funding and to ensure compliancy and to work with standards that are not yet standardized but are in the process of being so. And we know that the infrastructure for getting content from A to B in the digital realm is still incomplete, but more on that later. What we did conclude is that there will be no single source of funding to cover all monographs. So the people who say, well, there isn't a central budget, and therefore we won't have OA for monographs, that's not correct. There are lots of sources of money. And it'll be a mix and match in approach and a mix and match in terms of business models. And as I said, infrastructure is getting better. So here, there's a slide there as to which countries have mandates, which don't, but I'm not going to go through that, just to show you that it's different in each of the eight countries. And one of them was the UK. So here's my slide about what's happening in the UK right now. HESCI, Higher Education Funding Council for England, not to be confused with things that are all UK. Actually, HESCI has the contract to run the research excellence framework for both, well, for all of the UK. So with Scotland, which may or may not be part of the UK soon, for Northern Ireland, which may or may not be part of the UK soon, for Wales, that probably won't go anywhere. But anyway, for the time being, HESCI runs the REF. The REF is what determines the research funding for universities. And it's an exercise that's done every 6 years. It's hugely expensive, hugely controversial. But it's the carrot and the stick. And the good news, the great news, is that HESCI is absolutely dedicated to making books, making monographs and edited volumes that are scholarly volumes go OA very soon. Now, they will mandate it step by step. They have realized that it would cost them £20 million a year. That, in the current climate, when HESCI's being reorganized, when the country's being reorganized, when nobody knows where we're going, is probably too big a leap. But what HESCI is doing at the moment is devising a pilot project, which will still be several millions of pounds a year. So that's good news, because it's one of the few things in my country that's going in the right direction. I'm so pleased. So let's look at funding. We found in the landscape study that money determines everything. And we found a number of studies and a number of initiatives. A report that was done by a consultancy firm, they have found that there is a lot of money in the system. The US initiatives and library institutions and libraries, they're doing a lot. So Simba said, actually, they expect the growth of open access monographs to be 30% per annum. That's without the HESCI mandate. That's without taking into account what any of the big publishing companies may do. And I have to say, they are hiring up staff to do books in open access, do monographs in open access. And that's very exciting. So things will happen. So their 30% is just based on general trajectory that if everything stays as it is, there will still be at least $21 million a year going into OA. Now, out of America, let's look at what's happening there. There's a very big foundation called the Andrew Mellon Foundation, which has a real soft spot for American university presses. And there are about 100 of them. And they are funding to the extent of anywhere from $100,000 to $1 million each, about 20 infrastructure projects. Their view is if they get the university presses to work on building infrastructure collaboratively and also train people and improve capacity, that Monograss will go OA. There's the initiative within the university system to fund early career academics. This is money coming from an institution to pay for the publishing process of the young academics that they are keen to support and hold on to. But the publishing goes through the conventional university press route. There's a movement towards, who knows whether this will be successful, but spending 2.5% of the library budget to commitments to OA generally. That's books, journals, and the infrastructure. And then there are other projects like Lever, which will be publishing about 60 books over the course of 5 years, and it's funded by 40 Oberlin College, the Oberlin College Network. And Luminos, which is a nice project coming out of the University of California Press, is a it's a collaborative project where they've decided that the cost per title is about $15,000, and they would expect an author to bring half of that from their institution, and the other half is put together through library subsidy and through the UC Press and through revenues from the print sale, which will contribute to the publishing costs. So, institutions and libraries. Recently, as I'm sure it's the case here, there's much more interest in what kind of impact research has. And so, impact, dissemination, research funding, the links there are stronger than ever. And that is important for the institutions themselves, and therefore there's a new interest in experimentation with new publishing. There are new university presses coming along and coalitions of libraries working on setting up new university presses. In the UK alone, in the last 2-3 years, there are 26 new university presses. They're small, but they're wonderfully experimental, and they tend to be open access. So here's the slide about the segment about publishing. And what we're going to look at here is types of publishers, funding models, the cost of publishing, and getting to OA. I'm going to gloss over a lot of this because I don't want to take too much time. But it is interesting to see what is happening, and it's different from the debates around this are different from articles, because there are no companies making a 30% profit on Monograss. I only know one company that's making more than 10% profit on Monograss. All the others are either in negative or making 2, 3, 4, 5% profit. So one has to approach this slightly differently. So in the landscape study, we distinguished between four types of presses publishing Monograss: the traditional university press, the traditional commercial press. First one, OUP, CUP come to mind, the second one, Routledge, comes to mind. Then there are the new university presses, often library-based and initiated by libraries. And the poster child of this in England, the one that has a large amount of funding and support, is UCL Press. And then there are academic-led presses. Open Book Publishers is one of those. And then when we wanted to look at the different types of business models, we had to decide how we were going to do that. And we decided that's how you did it. You followed the money. and then the models came out of that. So the first model is where a BPC, that you all know, that's the book processing charge, is paid for by the research funder. That's a picture of the Wellcome Trust in London. They fund just about anything that has any links with medical history, for instance, and or current books, monographs on medical subjects. Others are following suit. Model two is where a BPC is paid for by an author's institution. And as I said earlier, universities are beginning to recognize the importance of the impact and therefore looking to find pockets of money to pay for going open access for authors from their institution. Model three is a membership funding model, and there are a number of new university presses that do this. The Lever Press that I mentioned, made up of 40 Oberlin colleges, and they've given the contract to publishing those books to University of Michigan Press. I hope I'm giving you all some ideas of what you do around here in Australia. The fourth model is crowdfunding. Now, we all know about crowdfunding and Kickstarter, but taking that and applying it. The first model I want to mention is the Language Science Press. These are top-notch linguists who, from around the world, have come together, created a press, and they got some seed money from a German institution who then said, after 2 or 3 years, you've got to be self-sustainable, so figure it out. And they did so by saying, okay, we're going to crowdfund through specialist research institutions in linguistics, through libraries that are in universities that have large linguistics departments, and through individuals from the academic community, the linguist academic community themselves. And so together this comes to be a package that is paying for 33 books a year. And they appointed Knowledge Unlatched to do the work, the crowdfunding work for them, their agents. And I'm going to come to Knowledge Unlatched later on. Model five, embedded institutional support. We found, not in the UK, which is terribly commercially minded and their university presses are expected to make money, except for the ones that are in the libraries, but we found that on the continent, that most university presses and academic divisions or even commercial presses got a lot of hidden institutional support. They found people in back rooms doing copy editing, doing proofreading, doing designing, doing typesetting. So these costs weren't coming up as costs, as they do where there's more transparency, such as in the UK or in America. So there's our person in the back room. And then the model six was the full institution support, which is like UCL Press, and you can see their accounts online and you can see how it's done. We also found a lot of confusion between what a BPC is and an APC. Apples and oranges. So what is a BPC? It still hasn't settled down. We don't know yet what it is that each company includes or doesn't include in what they're charging for going open access. It might be partial or full publishing costs. It might be partial or all income substitution. It may be that they're expecting print to contribute to the publishing costs. It may be that they're worried that there won't be any print publishing at all, and then there's no contribution from print, in which case they come up with a different fee. There's just too little experience yet. It's not as if anybody's trying to diddle anybody. They just don't know how these open access books work yet. And of course, should a BPC include a profit or a surplus? Profit is what you call it in a commercial company. Surplus is what you call it in a non-commercial company. And just in case you didn't know this, OUP and CUP give masses of surplus from their operations to their universities, millions and millions of pounds every year. And they don't pay taxes. So one of the things that we came up with was realizing that a BPC is not equivalent to the cost of publishing. And so we looked at, well, what is it that publishers do? I'm not going to go through that list or the other about 85 other things that publishers do, but they do a lot. In summary, there are pre-press costs, there are post-press costs, and there are costs associated with the ongoing life of a book to keep it in print. In print is a silly word now, but to keep it alive. There are overheads and then the profit surplus. But we really found that the BPC charges were very much dependent on what was being offered as a service. So we found one press that was just hosting content, Monomath, 500 euros, and other presses all the way at the other end, full Rolls-Royce treatment. So it's really about what you pay for, what you get. You get what you pay for. So transitioning to OA, some university presses are already a cost center and do not expect to recover costs. Flipping to OA is really easy. As I said, we found in many continental countries there were hidden subsidies, but there are also buybacks. This is what academic publishers lived off of for years. If you sold 200 copies to a funder, that was fantastic. These books usually stayed in some warehouse forever, not doing anything very useful at all. And the new initiatives are exciting, but they do need more support. So where are we now? Publishers are beginning to be happy with BPCs. Funding is emerging. And what we'll see is that traditional publishing will exist even as more go OA. Cost savings to be had by going into OA. I'm not going to go into that, but there are real, real cost savings. And if anybody wants to ask that as a question, I'm very happy to talk about that. Infrastructure. Now I'm going to go very quickly over infrastructure, and then I'm going to skip over to metrics, and then finally conclude with libraries. So, discovery challenges. Discovery and metadata. These are issues that particularly the librarians in the room are very familiar with. There's a gap between what the publishers think they ought to be doing and what you as librarians want publishers to be doing. And that's being recognized now and being addressed. So that's what we're going to briefly talk about. I'm not going to go through all of the slides covering discovery, the challenges, the metadata issues. But you'll see there's several bodies there that are relatively new and contributing to creating some order out of the chaos of metadata. So I think everybody in the system is realizing that it's absolutely top priority. Metadata and standards, universal standards that apply all throughout the world. Hosting, discovery, that's all happening. You don't need to worry about your OA books going lost, because that's fine. And there are guidelines all over the place that you can look at. And the value-added services are growing. And in particular, the usage metrics, which we'll get to in a moment.
there are new projects being developed in Europe through the Hermios Operas programs and the Mellon projects in the United States. And I think we're going to skip the content and services. Just very briefly, the big issues are who owns the content and who decides on licensing policy. So we'll, I can't resist talking just a little bit about this. Data analytics, hugely important, hugely important. Workflow processes and tools, they're getting better. But who's developing these services and what does this mean for the future? So now on to metrics, and I'm drawing this segment, from some new studies. Springer just published a report last week at the Charleston Library Conference in America. KU Research, which is based here, and which Lucy is a research director, has done a number of studies. And the second one was also launched in at the Charleston conference. KU Research has also done work with UCL and some really interesting work on geolocational data. So, Springer Nature study. There are about half a dozen slides like this that tell you all the detail you want to know about what is happening with usage, but this is the concluding slide. This is what's important to note. Downloads are 7 times more than closed books, and Springer Nature compared 350 of their open access books with 350 comparable closed books. These books were cited 50% more and mentioned online 10 times more than the equivalent. That is really powerful information. And here's the report that we did. I should say that we're a very exciting international team. I live in London. We have a little base in Michigan at the University Library there. We have Curtin here at CCAT. We have people working from us from all over the place. Alkin is from Turkey. This study, again, looked at a lot of different things. Where do readers come from? That's comparing the 4 university presses. You can see whether readers view chapters or download chapters. You can look at the proportions of viewing and downloading. You can compare through word clouds the popular subjects between open and close. But the point I want to make about, and I'm now moving into the UCL study, which again was a KU research study, social media tracking, hugely interesting. And we found that the referrals were predominantly coming from Twitter. That may not be a surprise to some of you, but it's just good to know where they come from. But the thing that I'm really excited about, and this was developed here, is tracking geolocational data. And geolocational data looks at the community around the university. So it doesn't just look at traffic coming through the IP address of the library, it looks at what is going on in the vicinity of the particular city or university. And here's what happened when we looked at MIT. Institutional downloads via OAPEN and counter-compliant, is that little thing over there, 37. Geolocational downloads in the Cambridge, Massachusetts and Boston area, 556. So if ever there was anything that one needed to justify going open access, that's certainly an exciting figure to look at. And that continues to be verified city after city after city, university, university after university. So my last segment is libraries. So I was thinking about, listing what I wanted to talk about in the same way as I had with all the other segments. But actually, I came up with this. Because libraries are in the center of everything. Absolutely critical for participating in this move to open access. And what are they doing? They're supporting authors and readers, facilitating discoverability, fostering new university presses, participating and supporting new initiatives, contributing to the debate, and supporting the change that we're seeing. And here's an example of something that you made happen. Libraries did this. When I came up with the Knowledge Unlatched model, people said, nobody will participate in this. The library said, publishers won't do it. Publishers said, librarians won't do this. And I said, okay, I'm gonna go and see. Well, the Middle East peace process is nothing compared to what I went through the first couple of years of this. But in the end, this is very simple. It's a crowdfunding setup. Publishers submit titles to the KU. There's a pre-selection process. At the moment, it's 40 librarians from 12 countries, and they whittle out the stuff that they don't think their readers want to have, need to have, or that they just don't want to spend the money on. Then that list, shorter list goes to the libraries. Libraries pledge or not, and if enough libraries pledge, then there's enough money to pay the BBC. But it's all aggregated together, and KU aggregates the orders and collects the money from the librarians and then distributes to the publishers. So far, it's like every other aggregator, but the big difference is number 7. The libraries then are unlatched. And I think some Americans were talking. The first time I heard the word unlatching as a verb, I thought, we've really arrived. Now we're on the map. And this is what the trajectory has been. We started in 2014 with only 28 books from 13 publishers. We immediately set up MARC records. We've been improving MARC records as we've gone along. Second year, 78 books from 26 publishers. Then we moved up to 343 from 54 publishers with usage reports and IP addresses in 2017. We have another core package of books. We've introduced journals. The Language Science Press is new. Geolocational usage stats. And KU Open Services. This is to help smaller publishers who don't know how yet to do this efficiently. And in 2018, because of library demand, we'll be doing STM books as well. So, the point about KU is it's a sandpit. It's not the only way to get books open access, but it is showing the way, and other people are emulating it, and that's just wonderful. So back to my octagon. Those are the areas that we have covered ever so briefly, but all 96 slides will be available soon. And this is where I hope we will be one day, a nice smooth circle where everything falls into place and everybody's working happily together with a system and a workflow and pathways that don't have blockages. So I would end there, but there is something I want to say, which is most of what I've said is talking about North America and Europe. There are other things happening on a much smaller scale in other parts of the world for different reasons and with different heritages of publishing. But as Australia knows better than most, power and wealth generally is moving east. And we're in a rather unpleasant period of history, at least from where I stand, up there in the UK. It was terrific being here the other day to see the results of the vote. Finally being in a country that's doing the right thing, absolutely wonderful. And the joy and the happiness of all of that. We don't see that very much where I live, and nor on the continent, nor in America. So I think that Australia has a very important role to play in helping keeping making knowledge as open as possible, because what we don't want is having access reduced. What we want to see is access to knowledge being open. So, thank you very much.
Association, because for me librarians and librarianship and all things libraries are about connecting people with information, and the Australian Library and Information Association has values, and I was just reading them and they were just so pertinent to what we're talking about. The first one is about the promotion of the free flow of information and ideas through open access to recorded knowledge, information and creative works, which of course is exactly what we're talking about. Respect for the diversity and individuality of all people, which is one of the things I really like about Knowledge Unlatched, and preservation of the human record. There are others, but those three just really spoke to me as fitting very much into this space. And so I suppose I was thinking about the fact that books have, certainly in the early days of open access, were seen as a bit of the last bastion, and how on earth can we make that happen? Which is why it was really exciting to work with KEU from the early days, because it seemed like finally here was a way to actually make this work that worked for both publishers and libraries and opened up much more content. And I suppose the final point that I would make is that sustainability is just so critical for everyone. So, like everywhere else, library budgets are sadly a fixed amount, occasionally up, occasionally down, and so budget management is something that we're trying to manage all the time, and is becoming more challenging, particularly in the journal space, as the journals get consolidated into fewer and fewer publishers. And so for me, the open access to books, being able to find a way to make that sustainable and also to really keep up that diversity of publishers, because I think particularly in the humanities and social sciences area, that different views on the same topic is absolutely critical. So again, being able to share that content more broadly, which is often being locked down in university libraries in many ways, the print version. So those were the things that I thought of.
Okay. Well, coming from a trade publishing space, which is very commercial, obviously, it's not a model that would work for us and for our authors, simply because they are coming from an artistic and a cultural bent, and they're process of writing literature or stories for children or cookbooks, photographic books and so on. That's their bread and butter, unlike in the academic world where academics essentially have a salary and what they produce is part of that salary. I guess it's publicly funded. So there is that notion that open access is a public right in a way because of that. But sadly, our authors rely on any income they can get through royalties, through book sales, through ebook sales, permissions, rights, international sales, that sort of thing. So it's a really interesting
comparison, you know, on average, an author in Australia, a typical literary author, would earn about $19,000 for a book they might spend 10 years writing. So they all have to have day jobs, and those day jobs keep them going.
Same sort of figure in the game.
Yes,
me too. An interesting parallel I thought was getting into the actual creation of, or accessibility of, the open access model is we, you know, every book that we produce, we also create an ebook. So it's available digitally as well as in print. And that's an interesting model as well, insofar as people say, oh, print books are dying, you know, nobody's buying them, are ebooks taking over? Well, actually, we've seen them plateau, and people tend to buy both, which is interesting. Take their ebooks on holiday and they keep their print books beside the bed. So that's an interesting, in itself, in that sort of digital, technological internet. It's really fascinating. I mean, I had all sorts of questions, but my questions are probably really dumb. You know, I'm like, oh gosh, how do you do this? How would you do that? So,
well, I think actually we're opening up to questions now, so I think you get first dibs.
It was interesting when you talk about the actual creation of the what the academics created in a monograph form and then making it open access form. What is that process? And is it sort of that sort of metadata process, or is it the format?
Okay, so there's either self-publishing, which anybody can do, whether it's a monograph or literary work or whatever, but then that bypasses the whole publishing community. But if an academic wants to be published by a conventional publisher, be that commercial publisher, non-commercial publisher, a new one, an old one, whatever, but somebody calls themselves a publisher, then they would take usually their idea, even before they've written the book, to the publisher. The publisher will help them shape it and develop it, and then it's the publisher's job to do all of the tasks that publishers do. And they do the creation of the metadata, they do the editing and so on, and the design and formatting. Increasingly, a lot of this is being automated, but someone has to manage it. It's project management, in effect.
Because when we create a book for print purposes, we don't necessarily have in mind the end user in a digital world. In that sort of academic way, from a metadata point of view, the metadata that we put on an ebook, for example, is very basic. But you really have to think about that before you even start the book.
It's only been recently that publishers have started thinking, or academic publishers have started thinking about the metadata for the digital edition.
That's right.
But it's a whole lot easier if you start thinking about all of this early on. And then having it go through the various channels. That's what we call the distribution. It's called channels. So it might go to a retailer like Amazon. It might go, the print might go to bookshop chains, independent bookshops. But they all need the metadata in the format that they want. And that brings me to the aggregators. Let me tell you about the aggregators. Can I just say something about the aggregators? These are the companies that are in the middle between the publisher and the libraries, or the bookshops. But the digital aggregators, they take the content from the publisher. They may polish up the metadata or they may not. They sell it to the libraries and they say, we're the good guys, we bring you this stuff. And they sell it to you for a huge amount of money. And we know, and there's been now recently some authoritative studies on this, their markup is 40 to 50%. So the publisher's only getting half of what you pay, but they don't tell you that because they don't have to when their salespeople are in your library or in the bookshop or whatever. Having said that, they have delivered a useful service, because somebody had to move the digital content around in an orderly fashion. But their main investment in platforms has now happened. Yes, there are updates and getting better in what they do, but they really could reduce their cut a bit, I think.
Does anyone else? Would it? Yeah.
Hi, I was just wondering how you reach those researchers who are the glass half empty. How you some good examples of people who advocate for open access in a really good way for researchers?
Well, ultimately it's kind of by example. I suspect when somebody goes into their department and has coffee with somebody else and says, well, my book has been downloaded X number of times through open access. And the person who's been very much against open access sees that and hears about it. It's just a matter of getting the community to realize that there are, yes, there are obstacles, but they can be overcome. And interestingly, what Hefke is doing, that in their study for mandating open access, they reckon that only 75% of all monographs can be mandated because of third-party rights issues, like history of art. You try getting the Getty Foundation to let you put in images on a Creative Commons license with no idea as to how many downloads they're going to be, because they're used to selling for the print edition, you can have this for X amount of money for a print run of 2,000. But as soon as you reprint, you have to go back and get more money. So it's, we've managed to get over all of this by, well, when I was at Manchester, what I did was I just put in a little blog and I'd say, this image cannot be put on a Creative Commons license, but it is available here, and you can get a low-res image there, but we cannot put that image in at this point. And so from my point of view, it was better to put the book in without the image, then not publish the book as OA at all. And so people are beginning to get used to this. So hopefully this percentage that have these obstacles will reduce. And of course, academics always compare sales, which is not the right thing to do, really, because the sales depends on how good your publisher is promoting the book. It really doesn't depend on the quality of the book. So when you start looking at downloads of open access books where there's no barrier to access, you have a different kind of metric that's a much more valid metric. So academics are beginning to think about these things. Does that answer your question?
Yes?
Francis, I want to go a step further back. Academics moving away a little, social science and some humanities academics moving away a little from publishing so many books because of the demands of things like the RAF and the ERA here. You know, I've done some research and a lot of them are saying we're getting this, we need to publish journal articles, you know. So,
Well, in the UK there's a pushback against that. The academics are saying, well, in this subject, we want to be able to do our monographs. And Hefke is having to respond to that. There's a very strong monograph publishing tradition in the continental countries. Less so in the Nordic countries, but everybody else. we went through this a few years ago in the UK. There was a huge pressure to just do journal articles. But as I said earlier, the writing of the monograph is the research process for so many of these fields. It doesn't mean you can't also publish in articles, but it serves a different function, and that's now being recognized. But the academics have to push.
Francis, one of the things we were talking about when we met earlier in the week was the comment that that we sometimes hear in libraries, certainly, that, well, anybody who wants to get hold of my research can. And, you know, we obviously try to counter that, but I think that is still an idea that's out in the ether and no doubt something that we've heard.
Yeah, and should I quote Mary Beard on this? Mary Beard says, I don't understand the need for open access. I can get anything I want from my library. Her library is Cambridge University Library. Well, of course you can. But as we get more of these statistics coming through, when an academic says, I can get, you know, anybody wants my research can get it, the argument that I put is, you know your inner circle. You do not know your outer circle. And it's the outer circle that your funder is looking for you to reach. And unless you make a huge effort yourself, you're not going to reach them. You want them to see your stuff, to find it easily, and make use of it. And then when we start having these statistics, like with the Manchester University Press, the average number of downloads for monographs that would otherwise have sold 200 copies is 7,000, then even if you dismiss half of them as being by parties who won't read them, ask your academic, do you know 3,500 people that might be interested in your work?
Yeah, well, the other interesting thing is when we did the JSTOR report, seeing some of the downloads from places where authors, I suspect, have very little notion that there might be an audience. So the Philippines, once we corrected for academic population size, the top downloader of the JSTOR open access books was actually the Philippines. And I guess that a lot of North American and UK-based authors are not consciously writing to those audiences, but the open access is incredibly valuable for researchers who are in places where they might not otherwise have access through Cambridge University Library.
And that goes for anything online, really. It's 24/7. And if you have access, it'd be interesting to see if your stats could break it down to, you know, are people doing this after hours, and where and when, and like most people online. Yeah. They want to do it when they're ready to do it.
Mm.
And this allows them to do it.
Yeah.
Yes, with no passwords. Does anyone else have any questions? Yes, Cameron?
Well, I think to follow up on that and take it to the next step, you know, so we live in a world where one has to defend not just the value of a particular discipline or of the humanities, but of universities, you know, of quality of peer review processes, or you know, again, look to the US, look to the UK, for what of this country for us, you know, a not particularly wonderful view of what it is that universities are providing. So, and I think the harder version of France's answer is, well, yes, okay, six people read your book, that's great. Six people is not going to sway the minister to not cut university funding or not require us to shift. And we need a community of people around these books, around this scholarship, to make the case societally. And it's not going to be made with six people or with 200 people. It's not going to be made with people who have access to university libraries. It'll be made by, you know, the people who come into contact with politicians and public policy makers, and that's got to be the thousands and tens of thousands and millions of people who you can reach. Why?
Well, that data's coming in. Open access for books is relatively new compared to journal articles. It just wasn't being done 5 years ago.
And we have, I mean, we do have that longer history, and some more of this data in the journal article space, particularly in the sciences, particularly in the medical sciences, but we know that there are huge populations looking at those articles now.
And the other thing is that publishing open access is cheaper. So that's something that's good.
It's also immediately updatable.
Yes.
And so it's current. You don't have to reprint it, or we have to trash all those books because they're out of date now. And was wondering what's happening in the Google and Amazon world, in the online Amazon and Google world, as far as open access goes. Are they wanting a slice of the action?
Amazon beginning to put the digital version, they're beginning to say it's open access, because they see the prospect of selling the print version. I mean, I've also said, this doesn't hold true for everything, but for an awful lot of books, the digital version, open or closed, is the marketing piece for the print. And publishers still make 80% of their revenues from print versions. So people like, in the humanities especially, still some parts of the social sciences, they really prefer, if they can afford it, to have the print. And that's fine. And happy to sell it through Amazon.
And the danger there is that it starts to blur the boundaries between the commercial world and the academic world, and people will start saying, well, I want this novel, or I want this memoir, or this history of South Australian colonialism, for example. I want that for free, but it's not actually an academic work, it's done by someone else. So that's the danger for us in the traditional publishing.
I see that. I think there has to be a message. This is about messaging, and academic print books are very much more expensive than trade books, so there's a price differential. But there is also a message. This is a monograph. This is not a monograph. Will that be blurred? Is it already blurred in that some monographs make it over to be a crossover book?
Yes, they do.
And I published one of them once, which was terrific fun. I was at Bloomsbury, in the academic division, and an editor came along with a book called The Precariat. And the salespeople around the table said, we can't sell it with that title. You have to change the title. And the editor said, absolutely, fought it. And the managing director said, well, I'll bet you £5 you won't sell more than a couple of hundred copies. So we published this on open access. One day there was a phone call from a professor. Thank God the publicity department said yes when he asked for a print copy for free. And this man went around the world for about a year taking this printed copy with him and showing people. It was Noam Chomsky. This book has the turnover in the paperback, it then went into paperback. It sold £100,000 worth of books. Well, that's phenomenal for something that started its life as an academic book where nobody even understood the title. And The Precariat has now become a word that's been accepted as those people who don't have fixed jobs, fixed abodes.
But it managed to sell that number of copies while being open access.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Which I think is...
But that's rare. That's the exception. The exception that proves the rule.
I would think that there's...
Yeah. I actually don't think it is that exceptional, in that a large number of academic authors are, of course, looking for a general readership as well. And as we talk about impact, and governments expect us to demonstrate impact, that's where we start to look at it. If we may have just got plenty of academic authors on their list who are not waiting $90,000 off their next title, they're drawing salary, and they're interested in a crossover readership. And we've got academic publishers in Perth who've got cookbooks on their lists. So this kind of blending between the academic and the trade has happened some time ago. And authors know that general presses, trade presses are good at one thing, that's selling to the public. Academic presses are good at another thing, which is selling to a library. And I would think if I was in a trade publishing situation, I'd be in some kind of hybrid lists that could do both things, that could be doing open access and general sales as well. Just in the same way that academic publishers are obviously looking for lists that can do both.
That notion of looking at both, but we couldn't, it would be commercial suicide to do that. We couldn't give our work away on open access.
Well, I don't think you're giving it away.
Can I comment on this? No, I think you're absolutely right for your press. I think you have to be a big press to be able to do this. Springer have got 350 books out on open access. They publish 2,000 a year. So, and hopefully those 350 will have more of an impact than they would if they were closed. The stats show that more people are looking at them, but of course, that doesn't tell you whether it really has impact.
But of course, when you bring up the Springer, you're also suggesting that there is, or indicating that divisions there aren't then academic publishing. The divisions and the separations within academic publishing. Springer is not a university-based press doing a small number of titles. There will be a very different type of book, there will be a different type of audience, they're creating different types of lists. I just kind of think it's a bit simplifying to say there's trade publishers and academic publishers and that's kind of it. It's a much more complex model than that.
It is, but I was given 45 minutes.
Actually, I can see people looking into this room.
I wasn't suggesting for a second that you were simplifying it.
No, I absolutely agree. But we need to be able to have the prototypes for both, so that Fremantle Press survives and does what it does very well, and well, let's say OUP survives and does what it does very well.
Yeah,
and also has its academic open access list.
Yeah. Within publishing houses, and there are big ones, they will have certain subsidiary groups which will do those kind of things.
Yes, absolutely. And it's hard inside a publishing house to get that crossover. That's why it's called a crossover, because it's not a natural thing. But every author thinks their book should be a crossover book. And every editor knows that maybe 10% are crossover books.
But there's also something else that's gone on with Australian university presses in terms of the fact that they have had to move into trade publishing and cookbooks because they haven't been able to generate the revenue that they need just to publish scholarships.
Which is a sad indictment on universities' abilities to support their presses
and if they
to do what they should be doing.
If they supported them more, they would actually find that if they went open access, the cost of going open access is less, the risk is less, because if you wrote that off as a cost, and then if you sold print, you might recover some of those costs, but you would never get into a situation that the smaller university presses are in now, where they are running at a cost, and the risks are incredibly high, and therefore they're publishing cookbooks.
Mm. Shall we? I can see, I suspect some engineers that keep thinking that they have this room. So if anyone has any more questions, please come and join us for catering, which will have magically appeared. And thank you for watching.